Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll-free 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and this hour we concern ourselves with Christian unity. Is there much hope of Christian unity? It's hard to know what's going on in the field of ecumenism. Maybe we are coming close together, or maybe Christianity, like so much of culture, is separating into smaller and less connected interest groups. We'll discuss all of that. If you have questions or comments about ecumenism, the current state, and the ideas that are undergird the whole ecumenical movement, 888-318-7884 is our number, 888-318-7884. Is it even important that Christians be united, or can we just accept the current state of division and, well, frankly, sometimes even disdain? 888-318-7884, that number. Again, our guest this hour is Professor or Dr. Eduardo Echeverria. I could probably say professor or doctor either. He is a professor of philosophy and systematic theology at Sacred Heart Major Seminary in Detroit. His doctorate is in philosophy from the Free University of Amsterdam and his STL from the University of Thomas Aquinas, the Angelicum in Rome. He's the author of several books, including Dialogue of Love, Confessions of an Evangelical Catholic Ecumenist. Dr. Echeverria, thank you so much for being with us this hour.
It's my pleasure to be with you.
So what does that mean, an evangelical Catholic ecumenist?
Well, you know, there's an article coming out in the seminary magazine called Mosaic, and they did they focused, each month or every time it comes out, they focus on a particular faculty member, and it was my turn this time. And the title of the article is called Christian ecumenical and fully Catholic. So an evangelical Catholic ecumenist, I think that means in the first place that I'm an evangelical, because I think that salvation is something that should be proclaimed, and we should evangelize people, call them to conversion. The evangelization is rooted in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. And so it's also evangelical because I'm committed to the authority of Scripture, the Word of God. I'm an ecumenist, as we'll see, because I think we need to heed the ecumenical imperative of Jesus from the Gospel of John, that they all may be one. The Church is, in fact, has an ecumenical commitment, and it's an irrevocable commitment, as John Paul II says in his 1995 encyclical Ut Unum Sint. And, of course, I'm fully Catholic because I think, the fullness of the means of salvation are contained in the Catholic Church. The Church that Christ founded subsists in its own right alone in the Catholic Church. And yet, at the same time, as Lumen Gentium, the dogmatic constitution on the Church, says, and it's reiterated in the Decree on Ecumenism, and then, years later in John Paul II's, 30 years later in his encyclical Ut Unum Sint, that they all may be one, that there are elements of truth and sanctification that exist outside the visible boundaries of the Church. And those elements are embodied in ecclesial communities. Particular churches with a small c, they have some ecclesial status, more or less. So I'm committed to ecumenism, and ecumenism is not, I'm not just ecumenical because I want to be better informed, but I think I'm ecumenical because, as I said earlier, there's an ecumenical imperative that Jesus himself gave us. The Church is committed to ecumenism. And ecumenism is really an exchange of gifts. It's not just an exchange of ideas, both the Decree on Ecumenism and John Paul II urge. It's an exchange of gifts. So I can go on, but we can get into that a little bit later. What exactly does it mean that it's an exchange of gifts? So evangelical, ecumenical, and fully Catholic.
And now, how did your journey, your own journey, bring you there? Because maybe that contributed to being an evangelical Catholic ecumenist.
Well, okay, so I was raised Catholic. I was born in Mexico, in Mérida, Yucatan, which is the peninsula right sort of below Florida. I was raised Catholic. My parents immigrated to the States when I was about 2 years old. I was born in 1950, so that makes me 67. I grew up in New York City in the Bronx, went to Catholic schools, Catholic grammar school, high school, Marist Brothers, an all-boys school, Mount St. Michael Academy in Bronx. But it was only in an evangelical Protestant context in 1970 that I actually heard the gospel, in the sense that my when I say heard the gospel, I don't mean to say that the Marist Brothers didn't live the gospel or and proclaim it in as they knew how, but my ears were opened by the grace of God at La Brise Fellowship so that I could respond to the gospel of Jesus Christ, committed my life to Christ, and for 22 years I went through evangelical Protestantism, the Reformed tradition, particularly Dutch Neo-Calvinism. Hence I spent from 1973 to 81 working on my doctorate at the Free University of Amsterdam, which historically was founded by Dutch Reformed Christians, Neo-Calvinists Abraham Kuyper and Herman Bavinck and G.C. Birkhauer and others. And then went through to, you know, ahead to Anglo-Catholicism. And then eventually, in 1992, I went ahead into the Catholic Church. I don't describe myself as a revert, because the notion of reversion suggests that I was going in one direction and then I turned around and I went back.
Okay.
But I don't think I went back. I think the 22 years that I spent in the various expressions of historic Christianity were in fact contributed to my eventually going ahead into the Catholic Church. So coming into full communion with the Catholic Church, in that sense, coming into full communion with the household of God, with the body of Christ, and so on. And many things that I learned as, you know, when I was in that sense outside the church, contributed to my return, if you will, to the Catholic Church. And that was in 1992. I was in Long Island teaching at Molloy College, a Catholic college, and then eventually went to Missouri to in 96 to teach at Conception Seminary College, which is a Benedictine seminary, a minor seminary connected with a Benedictine abbey, Conception Abbey, and then in 2003 came here to a Sacred Heart Major Seminary, and have been teaching here and writing and so on.
Well, if your story kind of begs a question then about ecumenism. Should we as Catholics, I mean, you make it clear, especially with your several references to Ut Unum Sint, that they all be one, that Catholics really don't have a choice in this matter. To be Catholic is to be ecumenical, I suppose, in a sense, that we must strive for the unity of all Christians. Does that mean everybody's got to become Catholic?
Look, yes, in the sense that the goal of ecumenism is visible unity.
Okay.
Visible unity. That's the goal of ecumenism.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what the church will look like when that goal is attained, you know, I'm going to leave in the hands of the Lord. Now, let me put it this way to you.
Okay.
If I describe a bit more receptive ecumenism. So receptive ecumenism means that ecumenism is actually an exchange of gifts. I often say, to put it in very sort of concrete terms, that I have been, as a Catholic, I have been discipled by Protestants.
Okay.
So they have deepened my understanding of the Catholic faith. For instance, so they have, in that sense, contributed to a fuller, not that they've said something that we as Catholics don't affirm. It's at the level of expression and articulation. In fact, the Decree on Ecumenism says, in paragraph 17, it makes the distinction between revealed truths and their formulations. So it says it's not surprising that in some cases, it's hardly surprising then if sometimes one tradition has come nearer than the other to an apt appreciation of certain aspects of a revealed mystery, or has expressed them in a clearer manner. So I think that's absolutely true. So my, for instance, we have a solemnity of Christ the King, and we share that with Christians, you know, with, and I'm thinking in particular here, Reformed Christians, the Lordship of Christ. Well, my mind was formed by the Reformed tradition in thinking about the Lordship of Christ. You know, Christ is Lord over every aspect of culture, and my mind was formed also by that tradition in thinking about a doctrine of creation and so on. So I think here I am. I'm sitting at Mass on the Solemnity of Christ, and I'm waiting for the priest, when he gets up there to preach, to say something about the Lordship of Christ over every aspect of human life, that we have to make choices, as St. Paul says, that are worthy of the calling that we've received in Christ.
Okay.
Or as even, you know, Lumen Gentium says in chapter 4 and 5 about the calling of the laity and being engaged in the transformation of the whole temporal order, Lumen Gentium says. So the Lordship of Christ is at the center of our lives as Christians, discipleship and all that. Well, I think the Reformed tradition, certain Reformed theologians have given, as the Decree on Ecumenism says, have come nearer to an apt appreciation of that aspect of the revealed mystery of who Christ is, have expressed it in a clearer manner, and the way that they've expressed it is complementary. In their theological formulations, the Decree on Ecumenism says, as a result, these various theological formulations are often to be considered as complementary rather than conflicting.
Yes.
So some of the things that those gifts have contributed to a fuller realization of the unity of the Church. You see, the unity of the Church, the Church is actually already one. The Church, unity of the Church is a gift. It's already there. And it's in the Catholic Church. That particular, the whole notion of unity, it's actual, it's real, it's already given. Because that we confess, when we confess, you know, the marks of the Church, one holy Catholic apostolic, the oneness of the Church, the unity of the Church is something that's already actually given. It's a gift from the Lord. It's grounded in Trinitarian communion and so on. But unity is also a task. And
I
so
see. Yeah.
My separated brethren can contribute to a fuller realization of that unity. And how do they do that? They do that, for instance, as the Decree on Ecumenism says, by having a more apt appreciation of certain aspects of a revealed mystery, have expressed them in a clearer manner. In fact, it says at the end of that paragraph that in that respect, they can actually contribute to a fuller realization of the unity of the Church. Catholicity is also a gift, but it's a task as well. It's not static. As we walk as brothers and sisters, because they're brethren,
yeah.
We mustn't think, I often tell my students or wherever I go and talk about these things, we mustn't think that these historic, like let's say the historic churches of the Reformation, Methodist, Lutherans, Reformed, and Anglicans, as if somehow that's an other religion. I don't think it's another religion. It's another expression of Christianity.
And we need to
And of
make that
course,
more, that unity that's there, more visible, actual, and real.
That's what, that unity that the church already, that the Catholic Church already has.
Yeah.
Because remember, the church that Christ founded subsists in its own right alone in the Catholic Church. But what we mustn't conclude from that is that, therefore, outside the visible boundaries of the Catholic Church, all you have is an ecclesial wasteland or emptiness.
Right. Fair enough. No, well, no. We have to, Dr. Echevarria, we have to leave it there for a minute because we have to take a break. Dr. Eduardo Echevarria is our guest this hour, professor of philosophy and systematic theology at Sacred Heart Major Seminary in Detroit. We are talking ecumenism. 888-318-7884 is the number. If you have questions for Dr. Echevarria on this topic of ecumenism, 888-318-7884. We'll be right back with more after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Catch Catholic Answers Live anytime at Catholic.com.
It could be said that anti-Catholic notions of the Church's history are the original fake news. With all the misinformation being spread, where does one look for the truth? In The Real Story of Catholic History, Professor Steve Weidenkopf gives you the facts on over 50 of the most common misconceptions about Catholic history and shows you how to answer them simply and powerfully. Whether it's to answer claims about Catholicism's supposedly pagan origins, old myths about the Inquisition that never really seemed to go away, or more modern errors that anti-Catholics put forth, The Real Story of Catholic History is an essential resource for every Catholic's bookshelf. Order your copy of The Real Story of Catholic History today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their faith and values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
The Catholic Answers Minute. I'm Father Vincent Serpa. In Luke 12:39, Jesus told his disciples that they must be prepared for and attentive to whatever he required of them. Basically, he was concerned with the R word, responsibility. Much will be required of the person entrusted with much, and still more will be demanded of the person entrusted with more. Being responsible means being attentive to another. Even though when people marry, individual freedom is curtailed to a degree, it is when they become parents that being responsible takes on a whole new dimension. Their new child is completely dependent on them. When some people rail at the Catholic Church, usually under all the negative talk lies resentment that something is expected of them. The Lord is clear, with faith comes responsibility. Elsewhere he says, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but those who hear the word of God and keep it. I'm Father Vincent Serpa for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. This hour we are talking ecumenism with Dr. Eduardo Echevarria, professor of philosophy and systematic theology at Sacred Heart Seminary in Detroit. Next hour, The Church in the News with J.D. Flynn, the editor-in-chief at Catholic News Agency. Lots and lots of folks on the line wanting to talk about ecumenism. Dr. Echevarria, shall we go to calls? Dr. Echevarria?
Yes, yes, please.
Oh, okay. I, all right.
You lost me.
Yeah.
No.
I panicked for a minute.
No, not at all. Go ahead, man.
All right. Tommy in the Bronx listening on Sirius Satellite Radio 130. You are on with Dr. Echevarria. Your question, please.
Thank you. How you fine gentlemen doing tonight? I appreciate you taking my call. How you doing, doctor?
I'm fine, thank you.
Couple things. Great. I heard your introduction. It's quite fascinating. Basically, I struggle with the next question I'm going to ask you. In terms of, realistically, the Protestants versus Catholicism, it's going to be very difficult for them to actually believe in the sacraments and also in the Blessed Mother, you know, being the Immaculate Conception and the Virgin, right? So I've had conversations with Protestants many times in my life, and it just appears to me that they're never going to believe in those two factual things that we have in our Catholic Church. So what are your thoughts on those?
Well,
it's really just a question.
Here's where, regarding the question of Mary, what's Mary's place in the plan of salvation? Well, I would begin in a conversation that I've had many times with Protestants on this. I would begin by with the Gospel of Luke, regarding Mary has a singularly unique place in the plan of salvation, you know, in the history of salvation. She's the mother of God. She's the mother of our Lord. In the Gospel of Luke, Mary herself says that all generations shall call me blessed, so that it's biblical to speak about the Blessed Mother. That's a self-description that is in the scriptures themselves, huh? So it seems to me that the place to start is trying to find some biblical starting point so that they can connect with you on these matters. Mary is not just a gestational carrier. She's singularly unique as the mother of our Lord, as the mother of God. She's the Blessed Mother. She is also the archetype of faith in the sense that her response at the Annunciation to the angel Gabriel, that she was to be the mother of our Lord. I mean, it seems to me that there are plenty of places to begin there. And then I would even go so far as to say, this is where John Paul II starts in his encyclical on Mary, Redemptoris Mater, Mother of the Redeemer. He starts biblically. He doesn't start with specific Marian dogmas, Immaculate Conception, Mary's Assumption, and so on. He starts by asking, what is the fundamental Mariological principle regarding Mary's place in the plan of salvation? It seems to me that we share many things in common there. We affirm many things about Mary. So, of course,
Tommy,
of course, the conversation goes on further, you know. Regarding the sacraments, even that, I think, there's division among Protestants themselves over the question of the sacraments. But with certain traditions in Christianity, Reformed, Lutherans, for instance, they too think that the sacraments are means of grace. They also think that the sacraments are efficacious means of grace. And you have to start by listening to each other and trying to find a point of convergence there, not because that's the end. It's not about mere Christianity. It's not about common denominator ecumenicity, but you have to begin somewhere. And since the Church regards them, Protestants as separated brethren, brothers and sisters in Christ, so we have to try to find each other then, and then move forward, so that we can deepen our understanding. Where are they? What is it that they think about the sacraments? Do we share a certain understanding of the sacraments? It seems to me, I went to give a talk a few weeks back, again in connection with Reformation 500, on Luther's Small Catechism. And in question 305 of Luther's Small Catechism, he asks the question, who should be baptized? And what does he say? He says, all those who wish to be saved. So Luther believes in baptismal regeneration. I mean, that's a starting point for discussing the nature of the sacraments.
Well, let's let Tommy. Tommy, did you? No, we don't have Tommy. Okay, I guess he went to listen off on the air. I do want to. It does seem though. Like at the root of Tommy's question there, and Tommy from the Bronx, thanks very much for the call. Is a sense of it does seem sometimes that we have a very long way to go, though, doesn't it?
Oh, I agree with you. I last week I was at two different places to give lectures, and at one point I said to the audience, I said, you know, it seems to me, I feel like sometimes I'm doing all the heavy lifting, in the sense that I'm reading Protestants of various confessions, and I'm trying to live out this receptive ecumenism. I'm trying to live out what John Paul II says, for instance, in Ut unum sint, where he says, how is it possible to remain divided if we have been buried through baptism in the Lord's death, in the very act by which God, through the death of his Son, has broken down the walls of division? It's not possible to remain divided. Division is under the judgment of God.
Eduardo Echevarria, Professor of Philosophy and Systematic Theology at Sacred Heart Major Seminary, is our guest this hour, and we are talking ecumenism. 888 318 7884. Your questions on ecumenism right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Dale Alquist of the American Chesterton Society, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Looking for a solid and dependable Catholic radio station in your area? One that's uplifting and authoritative? A trustworthy tool for the new evangelization? God may be calling you to a mission in Catholic radio. Find out how you can start a Catholic radio station where you live, powered by the truth of the Church and EWTN's dynamic radio programming.
Contact me, Jack Williams, at 205-795-5756 or jwilliams@ewtn.com.
Tim Staples, Trent Horn, Cy Kellett, Chris Check, Carlo Broussard. Our on-fire lineup of speakers will inform and inspire your audience to grow in their Catholic faith. For more information on booking a Catholic Answers speaker for your event, visit CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com today.
It might be said that anti-Catholic notions of the Church's history are the original fake news. With all the misinformation being spread, where does one look for the truth? In The Real Story of Catholic History, Professor Steve Weidenkopf gives you the facts on over 50 of the most common misconceptions about Catholic history and shows how to answer them simply and powerfully. Whether it's to answer claims about Catholicism's supposedly pagan origins, old myths about the Inquisition that never seem to go away, or more modern errors that anti-Catholics put forth, The Real Story of Catholic History is an essential resource for every Catholic's bookshelf. Order your copy of The Real Story of Catholic History today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We're inviting you now to join our radio club, where we send you a cool newsletter each week. And we don't pile on a bunch of emails and stuff like that. We just want to connect with you via the newsletter. And we send out these free talks from time to time. Jimmy Agin's talk, What the Reformation Was All About, from this year's conference, is up there for free right now. You can get that free MP3 where you can listen to the entirety of Jimmy Agin's talk, What the Reformation Was All About. When you join Radio Club, just go to catholic.com/radio club. Sign up now and get your free MP3 and be in our super cool club. I said cool several times to try to sell it as cool.
That is true. You did.
I hope I sold it. I hope that really sold it. Catholic.com/radio club. Our guest this hour is a professor of philosophy and systematic theology at Sacred Heart Major Seminary in Detroit, Eduardo Echevarria. Also has had a long journey through what we might call the ecumenical waters of the Church, and so is here both as a witness to the unity of Christianity and also as someone to help us to understand how we achieve the task of Christian unity. Carlos in Orlando, Florida, listening on the EWTN app, you are on with Dr. Echevarria. Your question, please.
Echevarria, how are you doing?
I'm fine, thank you.
The reason why I'm calling up is because at one point I was raised Catholic, and then I actually delved into different Christian churches, and I had like a rebirth of my faith, you know, and then I actually went back to the Catholic Church because I started realizing that some of these other denominations or non-denominations were just saying things out of context and stuff like that. So, but one thing I did learn from our separated brothers was that, you know, we have a unity with Jesus Christ and his salvation. But my hardest part is when I meet someone and I try to explain that to them, and it becomes like a bash fact. Like, you say one thing, then they attack you with something else. And it's a tit for tat. You know, it's like both of you going back and forth, you know, arguing about. I try to explain, but it ends up like an argument. And what's the best approach to keep the ecumenism and say in a nice way? I mean, I'm not trying to convince them, just explaining it to them. What do you do in a situation like that when it becomes heated?
Well, I mean, I It may very well become heated, regardless of what you say, regardless of how charitable and regardless of how you affirm that Catholics and let's just call them evangelicals, that Catholics and evangelicals are actually together, that they're actually united in Christ. I begin by drawing out the common unity that we have in Christ by virtue of our baptism. I also go on to talk about how, as I said earlier, the ecumenical imperative that Jesus gives us, calling us to be one, that's something that we have to work at. So, I mean, you have to get someone to actually recognize that there is that ecumenical imperative that they all may be one. Now, eventually, of course, there's also a need to have repentance. There's mutual repentance, mutual conversion going on, because we're the division in the church, okay, the division among Christians is something that we're mutually responsible for historically. And so this is why the decree on ecumenism says there can be no ecumenism worthy of the name without a change of heart. We have to move from an attitude where antagonism and conflict define the situation to one where each party recognizes the other as a partner, as having a common cause in the gospel. That seems to me fundamentally important. And then from there, you see, you can go on to deepen your understanding. You have to listen to each other. Listen to each other. And then you can express the differences that you have. But look, I remember saying just the other day to a Protestant, a Presbyterian, a pastor in the Presbyterian Church in America, and I said it to him because, in fact, he is suspicious of Catholics, you see, and so he's not prepared to call Catholics brothers in Christ. And I said to him, well, look, we confess together Nicaea. We say it every Sunday at Mass, the Nicene Creed, the Creed of Chalcedon regarding the person and natures of Christ. We confess the incarnation, that the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We confess that Jesus Christ died for our sins, that it's a substitutionary atonement, that Jesus took our place on the cross, that it's a sacrifice. We confess the resurrection of Christ, the bodily resurrection of Christ, Christ's ascension, that Christ intercedes for us at the right hand of the Father, that grace, it's grace that saves us. We confess eternal life, that to know Jesus Christ is to know eternal life. It seems to me, if you are able to convey that from the outset, that's a place to begin. Because then, you see, you get to a point where you have to trust each other in the conversation. If you don't trust each other, if you haven't moved from antagonism and conflict to a situation where each party recognizes the other as a partner, having a common cause in the gospel, and so on. If you remain I'm thinking particularly of the Protestant, but there are Catholics like this as well, who stand in merely in a protest relationship with Catholicism or with Protestantism. That's a stance that's stricken with unfruitfulness. You're not going to get anywhere then. You're not going to get anywhere then.
Carlos, how does that strike you?
Oh, that's amazing. And thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Thank you, Carlos. Appreciate the call. We're talking ecumenism with Professor Eduardo Echeverria today. And we go now to Rob in New Orleans, Louisiana, listening on 690 AM. Rob, your question for Professor Echeverria.
The guest had mentioned something earlier about how Protestantism and the different that are within Protestantism are not a different religion. And I guess that's kind of confusing to me as a Catholic, where we believe that we're the one true church. And I guess my question is, didn't Christ tell us in the gospel that whoever rejects you, meaning Catholic Church, rejects me, and whoever hears you hears me? So wouldn't they not only be a a different religion, but also a false religion?
Well, no, I don't think so. I just gave, I don't know if you're listening to the answer I just gave to the previous questioner, but the fact is, historic Christianity affirms, whether it's Protestantism or Catholicism, affirms all of the things I mentioned, Nicaea, Chalcedon, the Incarnation, the atoning work of Christ, that the cross is the instrument of our salvation, the resurrection, the bodily resurrection of Jesus, the forgiveness of sins, the ascension, etc. Now, you're asking me a question about the Catholic Church. I affirm that the Catholic Church contains the fullness of the means of salvation, that the church that Christ founded subsists in its own right alone in the Catholic Church. It doesn't subsist anywhere else. However, we mustn't conclude from that therefore, outside the visible boundaries of the Catholic Church, all you have is a wasteland, an ecclesial wasteland or emptiness. No, that's not the case. The Vatican II, the Decree in Ecumenism, Lumen Gentium, the Dogmatic Constitution on the Church, Ut Unum Sint, John Paul II's 1995 encyclical on ecumenism, says that there are elements of truth in sanctification. They honor the Word of God. They confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and so on. That there are these elements of truth and sanctification that exist outside the visible boundaries of the Church, and they don't exist in an ecclesial vacuum, John Paul says. They're ecclesially embodied in ecclesial communities, in particular churches with a small c, to a greater or lesser extent. On the other hand, once we recognize that there are vestiges of the true Church in these other particular communities, we mustn't then conclude that there are many churches. There's only one church. There's only one church, the Catholic Church. The nature of the church is to be one. That oneness is already given by the Lord to the Catholic Church. It's a gift, but it's also a task. Just as Catholicity is a gift, but it's also a task. Huh? As Catholics, we affirm that there's only one church, and that the one church is most fully manifested in the Catholic Church. So then the question becomes, what's the relationship between unity and diversity in that one church? And it seems to me that's the task of ecumenism. Christians are divided. The Decree on Ecumenism, the Latin title, Unitatis Ret Integratio, it's about the restoration of unity among the divided Christians. That's the calling of Jesus, that they all may be one. We can't say that it's another religion. It's another expression of Christianity. Some of the things that, of course, that they believe and the way that they express them are compatible with Catholicism, as the Decree in Ecumenism asserts. But, of course, some of the things that they affirm we consider to be false. They deny the ministry of Peter. They're not the point simply is, since they're separated brethren, they're still brethren, but they're separated brethren. They exist in imperfect communion with the church. And hence, the fact that they're separated brethren means that not everything that they affirm to be true is actually true. We think it's false. Their stance with their ecclesiology, their understanding of the sacraments at certain points, their understanding of Mary.
Rob, Eduardo, we got to take a quick break. Rob, I hope that was helpful and addressed your question. We're talking ecumenism today with Dr. Eduardo Echevarria from the Sacred Heart Major Seminary in Detroit. More of your questions on ecumenism for Dr. Echevarria when we come back right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, this is Archbishop Alexander Sample of the Archdiocese of Portland in Oregon. Keep that dial right here on Catholic Answers Live.
I fell away from the practice of my Catholic faith in my college years. But after I got married and we were expecting our first child, I had an enormous tug to come back to my roots. I went to an incredible Catholic store in my town and was blown away by the kindness and knowledge of the staff. They not only recommended books for me and my bride, but they promised me prayer support for my journey back to the faith. Wow, what an incredible Catholic store. I have to credit them for helping me on my journey home to the Catholic Church. Now they consider me part of their family, and I have shared with them my oldest son's desire to become a Catholic priest someday. An incredible Catholic store in your area can be found at incrediblecatholicstore.com. That's incrediblecatholicstore.com. The Incredible Catholic Store, transforming the world one soul at a time.
As the legend goes, the Protestant Reformation began when Martin Luther nailed the list of his grievances with the Catholic Church to the door of All Saints Church in Wittenberg, Germany. But do you know the whole story? In Catholic Answers' brand new documentary, The Protestant Revolution, you will hear from top apologists Tim Staples, Jimmy Akin, Carla Broussard, Trent Horn, and Steve Weidenkopf as they expose the errors of Martin Luther and of the other so-called reformers. This DVD will give you a clearer understanding of our Protestant brothers and sisters, and you will be better equipped to engage them about what separates us and about what unites us. Order your copy of The Protestant Revolution today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting shop.catholic.com, or by asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We're talking ecumenism with Professor Eduardo Echevarria this hour. We go now to Dennis in Wichita, Kansas, listening on 1360 AM. Dennis, your question for Professor Echevarria.
Yeah, good evening, gentlemen. I'm curious about how often in these ecumenical discussions misunderstandings, particularly in these heated kinds of discussions that you spoke to earlier, how can this come from just a misunderstanding of the terms used? And if you run into that frequently, I know I have several times, how do you deal with that? Are there certain ways to help us better understand what Protestants in general mean when they use the same terms we'd use in a different way?
Well, I think in the first place, there are many things, of course, that we share in common, as I was trying to make clear. But then there are some things that they have a deeper appreciation of, a more articulate. That's what I was saying over the break there, that it's not that receptive ecumenism is not saying that we're learning something new from a Protestant, as if he's sharing a truth with us that we don't affirm. No, it's at the level of expression. It's at the level of articulation. It's at the level of formulation. So his formulation of the Lordship of Christ, for instance, deepened my understanding of Christ's Lordship. So,
does that help?
Of course, you have to be clear on terms. But the fact is, if you begin by if we begin by affirming all those things that I've enumerated earlier about the Trinity, about Chalcedon, the Incarnation, the divine person of Christ, two natures, substitutionary atonement, the sacrifice on the cross, the resurrection, and so on. I mean, I think we can find each other in those doctrines and those dogmas, as it were. Now, of course, when we get more particularly into the question about the sacraments, the Eucharist, ecclesiology, the ministry of Peter, Mary's place in the plan of salvation, we're going to find each other on some points there, but of course, not everything is simply a matter of it being said differently, the same thing being said differently. No. It's not everything between us is somehow complementary at the level of formulation. There are some things that, in fact, they're contradictions. We don't agree with them. And so, but that's why the church has these bilateral dialogues, has had bilateral dialogues for the last half a century with Reformed, Lutherans, Methodists, Anglicans. I would say, in my view, one of the best books written on this, about those dialogues and the documents that have been produced, was Cardinal Casper's 2008 book, Harvesting the Fruits. In that book, he gives an account of what did those dialogues actually produce? What are the fruits of those dialogues? And then how far do we still have to go?
Dennis, thank you very much for that question. I hope it was helpful. And we go now, I'm just going to try to get to as many calls as I can here before we get to the top of the hour. We go to Frank in Dallas, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio, 910 AM. Frank, your question for Dr. Echevarria.
Hello, Professor. My question is that if Jesus is what unites or what we have in common with Protestants, and that's just not any kind of similarity, but really the supreme denominator, because Jesus is the fullness of God, and therefore to possess Jesus is to possess the fullness of God. And so with this as a basis or a foundation for unity between us and Protestants, do you think it would ever be possible for the magisterium to say, well, in light of that common denominator, which is not the lowest but the highest common denominator, could we then set aside, for example, the Marian dogmas?
No, absolutely not. John Paul II says authentic ecumenism is a gift at the service of truth, the whole truth. We can't say that simply because we confess Christ, even simply because we confess Nicaea and Chalcedon, you know, and that the instrument of our salvation is the cross, and that it's a substitutionary atonement and the resurrection and all of that. No, because the church contains the fullness of the means of salvation. It's the whole truth, the full truth, that we're visible unity is going to involve the whole truth, the full truth, the sacramental life of the church, Eucharistic presence, sharing in the life of the Trinity that's made possible for us through the sacraments and through the Eucharist in particular. So it seems to me all of those things, truth matters because doctrine and dogma matter. And so we can't have visible unity without attaining the fullness of that unity in terms of the truth. Unity and truth go together, and it's not just it would be in fact a common denominator ecumenicity, even if it's the highest denominator, to say Jesus, because then it doesn't matter. I mean, there are people who think that. We confess Jesus. Doesn't matter if I go to Mass on Sunday or if I go, you know, down the street to the Methodist Church. No, that's the Christ and the church are inextricably connected. You can't separate the two. Eventually, without the church, you really don't have access to the fullness of salvation, the fullness of Christ.
Dr. Echevarria, that's a very, very clear answer. As a matter of fact, that's probably the clearest no I have ever heard on this show. So I want Frank. Okay. Does the clarity of that answer help you, or does it address what you were getting at?
It does. You know what I was thinking, Professor, is something like Acts 15, where the first council gathered and said, you know what, as long as they do this and this, then we enjoy that communion. And I was just wondering if it was ever possible for the church to not say that the Marian dogmas are not dogma or not true intrinsically, but simply to say, you know what, again, like Acts 15, say, well, as long as the Protestants celebrate these feast days of Mary, then there could be a unity between us.
No. No, the fact is that unity has to remember, we're looking for visible unity. We're not just spiritual ecumenism already exists by virtue of our common baptism, by virtue of the baptism that we're buried, as John Paul II said, through baptism in the Lord's death, in the very act by which God, through the death of his Son, has broken down the walls of division. So spiritual ecumenism already exists. You can pray with your Baptist brethren, your Reformed brethren, your Lutheran brethren, your Anglican brethren. You know, if they're confessing, you know, Christ's Lordship, Christ as Lord and Savior, of course you can pray with them. We're not, you know, ecumenism isn't, we're not talking about interreligious relations. It's not as if you're, I'm saying, you know, the church is saying you can pray with a Buddhist, a Hindu, a Muslim, even a Jew. No, it's talking about spiritual ecumenism. But ecumenism is not just spiritual. It's at the end of the day, it has to do with the visible church and unity with the visible church. And since there's only one church, remember I said there's only one church, that doesn't mean that outside the visible boundaries of the church all you have is emptiness or an ecclesial wasteland. No, that's not true. There are elements of truth and sanctification that exist outside the visible boundaries of the church. On the other hand, recognizing the vestiges of the true church in those particular communities doesn't mean that we now become ecclesial relativists or pluralists, where we think that the church, that there are many churches, and that the Catholic Church is but a fragment of a larger whole. No, no. We have to go on to ask, what's unity and diversity within the one church, which is the Catholic Church?
Frank, thank you very, very much for that call. We move now to Gary in Upland, California, listening on the mighty 930 AM Relevant Radio.
Out, man.
Now, don't start yelling at me. Gary, your question for Dr. Echevarria.
Yes, sir. How are you doing? I wanted to see how we reconcile ecumenism with the previous magisterium, which almost universally condemned the heretics, you know, the iconoclasts, Arians, et cetera, you know. They never, like St. Augustine never sought ecumenism with the Donatists, for example. How do I reconcile those, even with later stuff like,
okay.
Like Polyamanos by Pius XI, for example?
Well, if I start with Pius XI, you know, his encyclical on ecumenism, Mortalium Animus, everything that Pius rejected regarding ecumenism, that it leads to religious indifferentism, to an ecclesiological pluralism, you know, in other words, that there are many churches, and so on, everything that that he rejected, the church still rejects. But the fact is, you can't expect, so it's all true what Pius rejected. But the fact is, Pius never asked the question, and hence his response to the ecumenical movement was one-sided, even if true, even if what he said was true, which it is, it was ultimately a one-sided answer, because he did not ask the question, well, what is ecumenism? What is a genuine ecumenism? And eventually, over a period of time, in Vatican II, the decree on ecumenism found a way to reconcile a commitment to ecumenism within the logic of Catholicism, the axiom that the church that Christ founded subsists in its own right alone in the Catholic Church, that the Catholic Church is the fully and rightly ordered expression of the body of Christ. Ratzinger said at one point, the council found a way, he said, within the logic of Catholicism for the ecclesial character of non-Catholic communities without detriment to Catholic identity. And of course, essential to Catholic ecclesial identity is that the Church of Jesus Christ is a single reality, that there's only one church, and it's concrete.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Gary, for that call. Dr. Eduardo Echevarria has been our guest as we discussed ecumenism. Thank you very much, Dr. Echevarria, for spending the hour with us. I hope you'll get built up a little passion next time. I thought you were really laid back today.
I'm sorry.
No, it's wonderful.
It's something that's on my heart, you know?
Amen, brother. All right. Thank you again. I hope we'll have you back very soon. And
all right. Please do. I'd love to come back on. Thank you.
Next hour, the Church in the News with J.D. Flynn, Editor-in-Chief of Catholic News Agency. We'll be right back with that after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free, 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to our Totally Groovy Wednesday show here at Catholic Answers Live. Great first hour, great second hour coming up this hour. Our guest is J.D. Flynn, Editor-in-Chief of the Catholic News Agency, and we are going to talk about the church in the news. So if you have any questions about the church in the news, 888-318-7884, our number, or if you prefer the spelling version, 888-31-TRUTH. J.D. Flynn, as I said, is Editor-in-Chief of the Catholic News Agency, which is a news reporting arm of the EWTN family with bureaus in the U.S., Europe, and South America. Flynn has written for First Things, National Review, National Catholic Register, and a whole bunch of other publications. He holds a licentiate in canon law from the Catholic University of America and a bachelor's and master's degree from Franciscan University in Steubenville. J.D. Flynn, thanks for taking the time to discuss the church in the news with us today.
Oh, Cy, thanks so much for having me. I'm glad to be here.
So if I may ask you about Catholic News Agency, I have witnessed its growth over the years from starting out a very small operation to becoming now an arm of mighty EWTN. Tell us about the agency and how you ended up the boss of it all.
Well, I ended up here at CNA by providence. I was invited to join this great team, and I started about 3 months ago, and it's been really a whirlwind for me of learning about all the good things that CNA does and seeing how it is that I can help. But CNA, you're right, has had really extraordinary growth over the past decade. It was started as a service to diocesan newspapers and other Catholic publications, providing news from the U.S. and from around the world, covering the church and covering the events of the world, and trying to do all of that with a Catholic lens to help Catholics to see the world, to understand the world, to act in the world, to think about the world as Catholics, to think about the issues of the day through the lens of the truth of the gospel. And we have grown in an extraordinary way, and I really credit that to our team, our writers, our editors, our video producers, our social media managers, and we continue to provide content, news content, to diocesan newspapers and other Catholic apostolates, and then we have a really great online presence through social media. We're on Twitter and Facebook and Instagram, and we're there just trying to give Catholics a lens on the world and what's happening in the world through the eyes of faith.
And that bit that you said about diocesan newspapers, you're appearing, that took a little time. I mean, I suppose it takes time to build up the trust of editors of diocesan newspapers. But I see, when I read diocesan newspapers, more and more of the work of a Catholic News Agency is there. That's a real service. Are you a subscription service, or how does it work?
So we are an editor service. We provide all of our content to Catholic media apostolates free of charge. So you mentioned that we're an apostolate of EWTN, and it's the generosity of EWTN supporters that allows us to do that. But we make our content available to diocesan newspapers, to the National Catholic Register, to other Catholic apostolates free of charge, because we think that what we're doing is, we hope that what we're doing is helpful and useful to Catholics. And we think diocesan media, diocesan newspapers, and other kinds of diocesan media are a really important part of the church's life. Yeah. And as media changes so much now, we want to find ways to continue to support them, especially as so many diocesan news outlets, newspapers, sort of try to navigate the digital continent. We have a great staff of young people who really understand the digital continent. They're natives to it. They think online as, you know, all the time, and they understand social media really well. And so we've been able to help diocesan news outlets kind of navigate that transition as well, which is a great thing to be able to do.
J.D. Flynn, Editor-in-Chief of the Catholic News Agency, is our guest. We're talking about the church in the news today. 888-318-7884 is our number. I have to say, in the world today, one of the things that is needed, and I do think this is what you're providing, is reporting. That is, so much of reporting, I'll tell you, even when I read what are well-established journalistic outlets, isn't really reporting. It's analyzing or sharing opinions and all that kind of thing. Catholics, I mean, the idea of know the truth and the truth shall set you free is a pretty strong directive from the Lord. How important do you think it is that there are outlets that are reporting, that aren't just, you know, taking a bit from the Twitter and the Facebook and the, and I know you, but and other sources and slapping something together and making some comments about it, but actually getting out there and reporting about what's going on in the world?
That's a great question, and you're right. It is really important. In the digital world that most of us now inhabit, we're so stratified and so segmented and so divided, and the ways that we consume news has become very divided as well and very stratified. But also, so much of journalism has changed and is changing, and really kind of being in a place trying to understand the truth of what's happening and trying to report that truth. Journalists report the news. They provide context, and they provide, you know, in talking with experts and witnesses and people who are involved in things, they provide not their own interpretation, but they provide a way of understanding what's happening and why it matters. And so we try to really be where the stories are, and then we try to talk with the leaders of our church and Catholic leaders who are involved in critical issues of the day to understand how Catholics can really interpret what's happening in our world right now. And as we are right now in such a divided and fractured culture, it's more and more important for us to be able to grasp the truth and to see that truth in the light of faith. You're absolutely right about that. So I'm really proud of our team. I mean, our reporters are everywhere, and they're looking for stories, and they're talking to sources, and they're just trying to get at the truth. And that's more important for us than, creating kind of getting clickbait or sensationalizing things. What's most important for us is really telling good stories and telling them well.
888-318-7884 is our number. I don't want to keep you from callers. We'll go to callers. But how much of that task for you then at the Catholic News Agency is as a, I don't want to say corrective, but maybe as a source that will tell the truth about the church in a more objective way than you'll get in the so-called objective media that often is grinding an axe or has an agenda? How much burden do you feel to do that?
You know, I think that one of the kind of great myths that has grown up, it's probably a relatively modern myth, but the idea of the totally dispassionate, totally objective journalist is a myth. There's no such thing. Everybody has a perspective and everybody has a bias, not even necessarily in a bad way, just a way that through which, a lens through which they look at what's happening. And unfortunately, I think what you see a lot in coverage about the church is people who are really bringing in not even necessarily on purpose, but just because of their own viewpoints, they struggle to understand the church on her own terms or to understand what the church is doing in the context of the gospel. Because religiosity is something that I think a lot of secular journalists have a very difficult time understanding, why faith would be a motivation for people to act as they do. And so I think because we come at journalism with an awareness of our own faith and how that impacts what we see and what we understand, we're able to understand the faith of others and the faith of the church. And because we see the church as a sacrament of salvation, we're able to understand other people who do that. We're able to understand Catholics who do that. And so to present what's happening in the church on her own terms and as she understands herself. We're not trying to, you know, our job when we're doing journalism is not to do apologetics. It's not to do catechism, you know, explicitly. Our job is to tell the truth about what's happening. And sometimes that's easy and sometimes it's very difficult. But but part of the truth of the church is the church's reality, that she is a sacrament of salvation, that she is a supernatural reality. And understanding that the church understands herself that way and understanding why helps us to get at what's really happening. At least I hope.
I think it's a well-founded hope. 888-318-7884 is our number. The church in the news is our topic today, and we talk with a man who spends his life in the news trenches as the editor-in-chief of the Catholic news agency, J.D. Flynn. If you have questions about what's being reported about the church in the news, or maybe what's not being reported about in the news, give us a call, 888-318-7884. We'll take a quick break, and we'll be right back with your calls for J.D. Flynn right after this.
Catholic Answers. Our success depends on you.
It's October, and as we head to the end of the year, Catholic Answers is kicking off its annual winter sale in its newly redesigned online shop with great discounts on all of the books, DVDs, CDs, ebooks, and MP3s that we carry. With great new releases on church history, scripture, Bible prophecy, and the saints, the shop at Catholic.com is once again your go-to place for solid Catholic resources with a store-wide discount to boot. Just enter the promo code WINTER at checkout and you'll save 20% off your total purchase. That's right, 20% off the hundreds of great Catholic resources we have in our online store from now till the end of the year. To get those discounts, just go to shop.catholic.com. That's shop.catholic.com.
As the legend goes, the Protestant Reformation began when Martin Luther nailed a list of his grievances with the Catholic Church to the door of All Saints Church in Wittenberg, Germany. But do you know the whole story? In Catholic Answers' brand new documentary, The Protestant Revolution, you will hear from top apologists Tim Staples, Jimmy Akin, Carla Broussard, Trent Horn, and Steve Weidenkopf as they expose the errors of Martin Luther and of the other so-called reformers. This DVD will give you a clearer understanding of our Protestant brothers and sisters, and you will be better equipped to engage them about what separates us and about what unites us. Order your copy of The Protestant Revolution today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting shop.catholic.com, or by asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Pope Francis said, "All of us are called to mature in our work as evangelizers. We want to have better training, a deepening love, and a clear witness to the gospel. St. Paul Street Evangelization's online School of Evangelization will equip you with the tools you need to be an effective evangelist. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you're unable to give, we'll set you up for free. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
720, yeah, if it comes from here.
Call now with your question. 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We are discussing the church in the news today with the editor and chief of the Catholic news agency, J.D. Flynn. How about we go right to calls?
Sounds great.
All right, we go to Patrick in Rockwall, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio. Patrick, you are on with J.D. Flynn. Your question, please.
Howdy, guys. So my question is, if I want sort of kind of a live stream news, sort of like the Associated Press has, but with less of a slant that the Associated Press has kind of taken on, what would you guys suggest? And is there like a Catholic version of the Associated Press out there?
Well, in some ways, that's what we're trying to do at Catholic News Agency. I'd say check us out at CatholicNewsAgency.com or download our app onto your phone or follow us on Twitter and Facebook and Instagram. We're trying to report 24/7 with breaking news, especially about the church or about things of interest to believers. We've got reporters in Rome, reporters in D.C., on Capitol Hill, going to the White House, going to the Capitol. Reporters through our sister agencies around the world, and so we're trying to do that. Now, the difference between us and Associated Press in terms of how much we put out is that they have hundreds of times more reporters and writers than we do, but I hope we're doing, I hope we're providing regular breaking and frequent news updates for Catholics who want to, who are looking for that.
Okay.
Sweet.
Patrick?
That works for me.
All right.
Get our app on your phone if you want, Patrick.
Oh, you should get our app too. Catholic.com. Yeah, get our app. Our app's even better. Oh, sorry. I'm sorry, JD.
They're two good apps.
Yes, they're both excellent apps, but ours is a little bit better. go to Catholic.com to get it. You know, they have this, like, you know, NPR and the National Public Radio, and they do news and commentary and that kind of stuff all day. Maybe we could get like a Catholic kind of thing like that. Are you guys doing any like audio news or news reporting that someone could tune into, for example? Not from 3 to 5 p.m. Pacific time on the West Coast, of course, but is that something that's out there?
Well, it's coming. So our partners at the National Catholic Register have Register Radio, which is a great show that talks about the news of the week in a good and Catholic way. We will launch our Catholic News Agency podcast in January, and in fact, this is the very first place that I am announcing that, so you get breaking news all to yourself.
What?
But we'll launch our podcast in January, and the idea is just to have an ongoing conversation with newsmakers and with the people who are reporting the news about what's happening. So I hope that we're going to be able to do some of that. But yeah, I think
you should have Catholic radio hosts on too
to
talk about what's going on in their life and stuff.
I'm going to slot you down in our list of guests. Right
what?
Now.
I'm sorry, I wasn't talking about me. 888-318-7884 is the number. So you cover things too. This strikes me as something so valuable that you do that you're just not going to see covered really in other places. There was that a conference on people with disabilities at the Vatican that you recently covered. How do you decide about covering that stuff? And what did you cover there?
Yeah, so that's a great story that a great event that we recently had a bunch of stories about, actually. You know, in Rome, there's so much going on. We cover, of course, every day when the Pope celebrates Mass in Rome, we cover his homily. We cover the Wednesday audience that he does. We cover events that are, you know, news that's breaking from the Vatican. But we also try to cover just the panoply of things that the Roman Curia is doing. And this is a great example of a conference that was put on by one of the offices of the Vatican, in addition to catechists from around the world. And they had hundreds of catechists from around the world talking about the question of how to meaningfully form people in faith who have intellectual disabilities. And so sharing ideas and best practices, a woman with Down syndrome gave a very beautiful talk about her own experience with disabilities. And we were able to interview her after she gave that talk. Some curial officials gave some talks. Holy Father himself met with this group. This conference was an idea that Pope Francis was really championing and trying to move forward in the Vatican. And so we were able to be there and to hear some of these best ideas and best practices about catechesis for people with disabilities, and then to do some coverage about it. I have our family has two children with Down syndrome, and so this was a kind of special thing for me that we were able to cover. And I was really glad that we were able to give it the coverage it deserves. But we try to look and see what are the issues that are happening in the life of the church, and how is the church, what are the issues that are being discussed in the world, and how is the church responding to them? So the rights of people with disabilities, the inclusive education for people with disabilities, the needs of people with disabilities, all those are part of the public conversation right now. And the church is responding with her own conversation about how to catechize people with intellectual disabilities. And so it seemed like something that really fits in what we're trying to do, which is show the breadth of the church's ministry and her efforts to form people in faith.
But I have to tell you, I mean, like you, the church is doing that, but and the topic of the show is the church in the news. But in some ways, it's the church not in the news, because apart from your coverage, I wonder how much that ever would have been covered. And I, just to prepare for the show today, I Googled Catholic Church to see what news would come up. And so then the Google News app there, and every single story was about the Catholic bishops in the United States translated the rite of exorcism into English. And it's a nothing story. It bears on nothing. It's just a translation of a text. And yet it has the word exorcism in it. And I sometimes feel that we Catholics are reported on as if we're exotic animals, kind of. Do you ever get that feeling?
Yeah, I think it goes back to, and first of all, I think that there is some merit to some of the coverage about the translation of the rite of exorcism. I don't want to totally denigrate it, because there are other Catholic news apostles that covered it and I think did it well. But your point is one that I keep coming back to, which is that the secular media has just a hard time understanding what we're about. And so, yeah, these things that are kind of flashy, and exorcism is very flashy because, you know, so many movies and things like that, the mystique of exorcisms and or what people think exorcisms are in popular culture. So sort of the church gets these sort of very kind of kitschy niche coverage, where our beliefs are seen to be sort of like a cute sort of
old-fashioned ideas, or, you know, very, very oftentimes nearly vitriolic coverage of our views on moral issues or
Catholic
social teaching.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Let's go to Francesca, driving through Massachusetts, listening to the Station of the Cross, 1460 AM, which sounds almost like a description of heaven. Francesca, your question for JD.
Oh, hi. Can you hear me okay?
Pretty much. Talk as directly as you can into the phone. It's not a great connection.
Okay. Let's see. My question is, I'm a Catholic convert 3 years, and so I've been listening to EWTN for years, and I'm really enjoying EWTN News Nightly and the world over. And so my question is, you know, there's good pro-life coverage, which I really appreciate, and at the same time, I find that there's, you know, almost next to none, except when they quote Pope Francis, but next to none coverage about the environment. And then also, especially, what our current administration is or is not doing about it.
Francesca, I'm just going to repeat it for any listener who may not be able to, because the connection is kind of rough. So Francesca is asking J.D. Flynn, editor-in-chief at the Catholic News Agency, why so little coverage about the environment, except when Pope Francis says something about the environment in the Catholic press, and also why so little coverage of the Trump administration or the present administration and their environmental approach, that kind of thing. J.D.?
Well, I guess, Francesca, first of all, thanks for your call, and I'm glad you're watching EWTN News Nightly. They're a partner of ours. I hope we're covering environmental issues and covering them responsibly. I just took a look at our site, and in the past few months, we've covered the Catholic Climate Covenant, which is an initiative of the USCCB, pretty extensively, and I'm glad we've been able to do that coverage, because we don't want to be, and this gets to the heart of your question in some ways, Catholics are not... we're Catholics before we're partisan, and our beliefs are broad, and no one political party expresses the fullness of the Catholic faith or the moral and social teachings of the Catholic faith. And so we have to be very careful, I think, to avoid putting a partisan identity or a political kind of ideology ahead of our faith and ahead of the teachings of the church. So I do hope that we're covering environmental issues and covering them well. At the same time, you know, yeah, it's true that I think the church or Catholic media apostolates and even maybe the messaging of the church give priority to certain issues. In Laudato Si, Pope Francis says that you can't have true ecological justice in a society which allows for abortion, the unjust and direct killing of unborn children. He says that they're absolutely incompatible. And John Paul II talked about that a lot in Evangelium Vitae. He says that you can't have justice of any kind in society if it's predicated on the falsehood and lie of abortion. And so we see certain, at least from our vantage point at CNA, we trying to follow the guidance of the church, of Pope John Paul II, of Pope Benedict, and of Pope Francis in Laudato Si. We do see a primacy and an urgency to certain moral issues, and perhaps that leads us to call Catholics' attention to them. But I hope at the same time we are talking as Catholics about the environment and our responsibility to be good stewards for the world the Lord has given us, because it's right there in Genesis, laid out clearly for us that we have an obligation to be stewards of creation, and it's an important thing. So I think it's a both and. Yes, we're covering issues that Pope Francis says are the absolute moral priorities of our time, especially the scourge of abortion. But I hope we're covering these questions about our stewardship of the environment as well.
Francesca, we do have that bad connection with you, but I'd like to give you a chance to respond because I think there are many people who share your concerns. And so your response to J.D.
Okay. Thank you so much. I did have another question, and that was, is it that Catholic News Agency is covering it and EWTN News Nightly is just not doing it or is not, you know? Is that the reality? What is happening?
Okay, J.D.?
I'm not sure that I can really speak to the coverage of other agencies, even the ones that we partner with. But I know that for EWTN News Nightly, which we are a partner with, I know that reporting on the
full teachings of the faith is important and is something that we all take seriously. I think we're all trying to do self-examination about how to report on the fullness of the faith and of Catholic social teaching. So I just can't speak to what another news apostle is doing or isn't doing, in large part because I don't know. I probably don't have just the expertise to be able to say, but also because those decisions are a discernment that I think we have to make on a day-to-day basis, and we often make them on the fly, and I think we hope we do the best we can to cover the panoply of Catholic social teaching. And I think that as far as I can see, our partners at EWTN News Nightly and our other partner apostolates are doing that as well as they can. But your point is well taken in that it's always a discernment for us, for any Catholic news entity, to discern how to cover things. And I think, you know, again, the church's own teaching gives us some guidance, which is that there are some issues which have necessarily a kind of prioritization. And abortion in the United States is our great national shame. And so I'm not ashamed if we cover that day in and day out because it matters.
Francesca, thank you very, very much for that call. J.D. Flynn is our guest this hour. We're talking the church in the news. Any question you have on the church in the news, how the church is reported on, how the church is not reported on, or a news story you'd like to know more about, J.D. Flynn here to take your calls, the editor-in-chief of the Catholic News Agency. More right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live.
Just like the saints of the Counter-Reformation, our own souls are in constant need of reform, of reconversion to God and His will for us. We struggle with sin. We become distracted in prayer. We find it hard to be loving and easy to be selfish. In Reform Yourself, Sean McAfee shows you how these magnificent saints can be guides to your own personal transformation. We all need to reform our souls. Let the saints who reformed the church show you how. Order your copy of Reform Yourself today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
It might be said that anti-Catholic notions of the church's history are the original fake news. With all the misinformation being spread, where does one look for the truth? In The Real Story of Catholic History, Professor Steve Weidenkopf gives you the facts on over 50 of the most common misconceptions about Catholic history and shows how to answer them simply and powerfully. Whether it's to answer claims about Catholicism's supposedly pagan origins, old myths about the Inquisition that never seem to go away, or more modern errors that anti-Catholics put forth, The Real Story of Catholic History is an essential resource for every Catholic's bookshelf. Order your copy of The Real Story of Catholic History today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Looking for an on-fire Catholic speaker for your event? Catholic Answers speakers will inform and inspire your audience to grow in their Catholic faith. For more information on booking a Catholic Answers speaker, visit CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com today.
Catholic radio, I believe, is the greatest tool for evangelization that the church has today. And I know this because we hear from people all over the world that tell us all the time they came to faith in Christ, in the Catholic Church, through Catholic radio. Guy that lives right next door to you, he might not ask you about your Catholic faith, but he'll ask us. He'll call in and say, "Tell me about the Catholic Church."
Dr. David Anders thinks Catholic radio is important. So should you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Don't forget about our annual winter sale going right on right now, despite the fact that winter is nowhere in sight. That goes until the last day of the year, December 34th. And you get all books, CDs, DVDs, ebooks, tracks, and MP3s for 20% off until the very last day of the year. Oh, it's not the 34th? Okay. Visit shop.catholic.com and take a look at all the great deals we have. Shop.catholic.com. This hour, we're talking about the church in the news, and J.D. Flynn is our guest. J.D. Flynn is the perfect guy to talk about the church in the news because that's his life. He is the editor-in-chief of the Catholic News Agency. JD, when we went to the break, you were talking a little bit about abortion as our great national shame. But one of the ways that the Catholic Church is making itself distinct from the culture more and more is its teaching on marriage. Not everybody likes that. As a matter of fact, I would venture to guess maybe the majority are not thrilled with that. That the Catholic Church does not just go along. Although I do think there's some unfairness too in about how that's reported. But now at Georgetown University, you've got a pro-marriage group formed there, and that is controversial. And why at a Catholic university is a pro-marriage group controversial? What's going on there?
So this is a group. It's a great question. It was a story that we're continuing to follow. It's a student group called Love Saxa. I think Saxa is some kind of term that they use at Georgetown. I don't exactly know. But this group's called Love Saxa, and they're a student group at Georgetown. And they their focus is really on encouraging their fellow students to chastity, on fighting pornography, on encouraging them to have healthy relationships. And in the context of that, they have a position on marriage that's consistent with the position of and teachings of the Catholic Church. So they teach that marriage is a lifelong covenant between a man and a woman, and that marriage is the best environment for children, and the children have a right to a mother and father. And so they teach these things, although really a lot of their work has to do with helping people have freedom from pornography and find chastity in their relationships. But they've come under fire this semester at Georgetown because a number of other students have taken offense at their stance, their views, which are the views of the Catholic Church about marriage, and said that they represent intolerance and homophobia, and that they foster, you know, because of their teaching of the representation of the teachings of the Church, foster an atmosphere of intolerance or possibly even hatred of people who have same-sex attraction. And so a petition was filed by some students, a student senator at Georgetown, and supported by some student or gay pride organizations at Georgetown, asking that this group be sanctioned, possibly lose its funding from the university or lose its right to use university facilities in its work. And the Hoya, the newspaper, the student newspaper at Georgetown, wrote an editorial affirming this, saying that these students are promoting intolerance and homophobia by teaching what the Church teaches at a Catholic university. And so they'll have a hearing. Their hearing was originally scheduled for the 23rd of October, but it was pushed back. They asked for it to be pushed back because they got very short notice about the hearing. But they'll have a hearing on October 30th with the leadership of the kind of University Student Association, student leaders of the University Student Association, which will make a recommendation about whether they should continue to be funded or continue to be officially recognized by the university. It's really a strange story because these are Catholic students who believe Catholic things at a Catholic university. And thus far, it's their fellow students who have lashed out against that and said that that's not consistent with Georgetown's values and those kinds of things. The administration of Georgetown is letting the process play out. They haven't they haven't really weighed in a substantive way yet, although, to be fair, that there is a process that student groups go through and there's a complaint filed. And so we'll continue to cover the story to see if indeed these students are judged at a Catholic university to be intolerant or homophobic because of their Catholic views. And if so, how the university will respond to that and how the Church will be able to respond to that.
Wow. That's one. Watch this space. I mean, we're going to follow more of that. You can get, I assume you will be doing ongoing coverage at the Catholic News Agency on that.
We will. So I'm proud to say we broke this story after the Hoya reported it this week, and last week, and we've been able to talk with the president of Love Saxa, and we're kind of soliciting some responses from Catholic leaders now, and then we'll wait to see what happens with the hearing and continue to cover it. But it's an important story. I mean, the one thing it tells us, first of all, is just how interesting it is that so many students at a Catholic university are offended or upset that Catholic teaching is going on there, even by their fellow students.
Yes.
And how much of really that, what that tells us is how much of a work of evangelization is needed, even at Catholic universities. But it'll also be interesting to see. I mean, the leadership of Love Saxa, the group, have said that they're optimistic that the university will support them. And it'll be interesting to see how that plays out.
J.D. Flynn, the editor-in-chief of Catholic News Agency is our guest this hour. We're talking the church in the news, and we go now to Samantha in Houston, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio, 1430. Samantha, your question for J.D. Flynn.
Hi. Hi, Si. Hi, J.D. Thanks for having me on.
Hi.
Well, I'm this wonderful work you're doing. I've thought for a long time that Catholic news needs something sort of analogous to the AP, and it seems like that's what you're doing. I'm calling because I am a medical feature journalist, and I also write for the financial sector, and I would love to get involved in Catholic News Agency helping you, and I was wondering if there's any openings, anything. I would even do it for as a volunteer for a while. You know, it would be wonderful.
So we're doing job interviews on the air now. Is what we're doing.
Yeah, well, the producer let me in.
I'm glad to. No, it's wonderful. We need good journalists. We need journalists who are trained and able to do the job in Catholic media. So, are you growing and hiring?
We are growing. I mean, I don't know what we have right now, but we are growing, and we always want to talk with good people. So, I'll say this: maybe what you could do is, if you have Twitter, reach out to me on Twitter at JD Flynn, or if you reach out to us through the email address on our website, and just remind us that you and I talked on the radio. So news@catholicna.com. And sure, I'd love to talk, but I'd make another point too, which is, you know, we do need good Catholics who are doing Catholic journalism. We also need, and we, I think, really sorely need good and faithful Catholics who are engaged in the work of secular journalism, because I talked about before the fact that secular journalists so frequently have a hard time understanding who the church is or what faith is or why it matters in people's lives. And so we're doing that here at CNA, but I think the more good and faithful Catholics and believers who are a part of the secular media, the more that tide can begin to turn. And so I look at a lot of believers I know who work in secular media, and I think their work is critically important as well, and I'm glad for that. So yeah, let's talk, but I think what you're doing, I think what you're doing, you shouldn't underestimate how important that is as well.
Samantha, thank you very, very much for that call. 888-318-7884, our call. We're talking the church and the news with J.D. Flynn, editor-in-chief of the Catholic News Agency. J.D., I have to apologize to Vicki from northeastern Minnesota, who called to say winter is around the corner. Apparently, they have a different kind of winter up there than we have down here. Who knew? Who knew it?
Who knew? I'm looking out at snow on the mountains here in Colorado, so San Diego's just its own kind of place.
I wasn't aware of that. Our weather is different. All right, Grover in Marble Falls, Texas, where I bet it's not winter yet, listening on 88.5 FM. Grover, your question for J.D. Flynn.
Thanks, Si. J.D., have you become suspect of some of these news agencies on the Internet and whatnot that claim they're Catholic? I'm really starting to wonder about, especially a couple of them. One of them does a play on words in its name, similar to the radio newscast. And there's another one that uses y'all's initials. And Do you know what they're up to? Are they anti-Catholic, or are they just off base?
You know, the specific sites that you're referring to, I'm not sure about, but I will say, yeah, there is a lot. The internet makes it very easy for there to be a lot of, you know, so-called fake news out there, and Catholicism is not exempt from that. I think we have to be really careful to evaluate when we're reading news. I think we always have to be really careful to evaluate what's going on. Are we getting reported facts? Are we getting, you know, facts at all? Are we getting, when we have commentary or quotes in a story, are they coming from experts? Are they coming directly from a source, or are they being, you know, attributed through a third party or something like that? So media literacy is something that a lot of Americans, not just Catholics, are needing to get better and better at, because there's so much of a profusion of really just, you know, I hate to use the trite phrase, but of fake news, of just kind of all kinds of people with all kinds of agendas representing themselves in as objective and legitimate news agencies who aren't. So again, I'm not familiar with the sites that you're talking about, but it can be difficult even to tell the difference between what's real and what isn't. So the more you can go with sites that you can trust for your news, and with outlets that you can trust for Catholic information, I think the better you are. And it's always good to look, you know, I mean, if you look at an entity's sort of Twitter feed, and they have
a very small number of followers, that's probably a good sign. If all of their coverage seems to be vitriolic or personally, criticizing people or bashing people, I mean, that's probably a good sign. If they're, again, if their sources don't seem to be legitimate, or if they're not talking to expert sources about things, that's probably a good sign that you're not looking at something legitimate. So, yeah, there's a lot of stuff out there, and it's easy to share, and it's easy for it to get spread. But if you stick with, if you do your best to stick with legitimate news sources, I think you'll be okay. Catholic News Agency, I'd recommend. Catholic Answers, for all the things it does, I'd recommend. The National Catholic Register, again, EWTN, EWTN News Nightly, those are good places to go. There are others as well, but we do have to be careful because there's a lot of falsehood out there.
Grover, did that address your concern?
Yeah, in fact, I heard him. Some of them are really tricky. I'll always Google the name of the outfit, and so often it'll just be one guy.
Oh,
right, exactly. Yeah, you get to...
That's smart.
I mean, there are probably people who are just all by themselves doing good stuff, but you got to be careful too.
We have to take a quick break. Grover, thank you very much for the call. We're talking the church and the news. I'm going to ask you a little bit about Pope Francis and reporting on Pope Francis and the sometimes controversies that surround our current pope when we come back, J.D., so get ready for that. I am Cy Kellett, your host. This is Catholic Answers Live. Our number, 888-318-7884. We'll be right back after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Harry Connick Jr., and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Hey everyone, guess what? It's October, and that means Catholic Answers is kicking off the annual winter sale in their online shop with great discounts on all of the books, DVDs, CDs, ebooks, and MP3s that we carry. With great new releases on church history, scripture, Bible prophecy, and the saints, the shop at Catholic.com is once again your go-to place for solid Catholic resources with a store-wide discount to boot. Just enter the promo code WINTER at checkout in our newly redesigned shop, and you'll save 20% off your total purchase. That's right, 20% off of hundreds of great Catholic books, DVDs, CDs, ebooks, and MP3s from now until the end of the year. That's shop.catholic.com.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
The Catholic Answers Minute. I'm Father Vincent Serpa. In Luke 12:39, Jesus told his disciples that they must be prepared for and attentive to whatever he required of them. Basically, he was concerned with the R word, responsibility. Much will be required of the person entrusted with much, and still more will be demanded of the person entrusted with more. Being responsible means being attentive to another. Even though when people marry, individual freedom is curtailed to a degree, it is when they become parents that being responsible takes on a whole new dimension. Their new child is completely dependent on them. When some people rail at the Catholic Church, usually under all the negative talk lies resentment that something is expected of them. The Lord is clear, with faith comes responsibility. Elsewhere he says, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but those who hear the word of God and keep it. I'm Father Vincent Serpa for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. J.D. Flynn is our guest. J.D. is the editor-in-chief of Catholic News Agency, and we're talking the church in the news. I warned you a little bit that I wanted to ask you about reporting on the Pope, but I want to put it in a wider context. There's some polarized feeling in our culture. I don't know if you've noticed this, but I didn't mean to surprise you with that, but there's some polarization. And in many instances, instead of being a communion of love, the church is itself polarized. It imitates the society rather than the other way around. And so I note that some reporting on Pope Francis I wonder how difficult it is. I want to ask you that. How, in this polarized atmosphere, how difficult is it to report on Pope Francis because Catholics are divided, I think?
In this polarized atmosphere, it is difficult to report on everything.
I see.
I find
So I think, you know, Pope Francis is not alone on that. But look, we have a very divided country politically. We are increasingly seeing that we have a divided country socially in many ways. And the church, I think, is in a period where, yeah, there are a lot of differing opinions on the Pope. There are a lot of differing opinions on the church's leadership, on the church's direction. And so that is a challenge. I think, you know, the good thing for us is that we're not in the business of bashing anybody, and we want to be loyal sons and daughters of the church. And so we believe at Catholic News Agency that the Pope is the successor of St. Peter and the principle of unity in the church. And we are edified by his ministry, edified by his witness. I had a chance to meet the Pope 2 weeks ago, and it was a really spiritual experience.
Wait, talk about name dropping. What? You just slide that in. You just met the Pope 2 weeks ago?
You know what's funny is he's at a meeting today, and he just told somebody, yeah, I met the editor of Catholic News Agency 2 weeks ago. So
I bet he did. I'm sure he did. I bet he's been telling everybody.
Yeah, I did. So that was a great privilege. But so, I mean, we want to report on the Pope because he's the principle of unity. It's a different thing, I think, and something that is a challenge to report on ideas. And there's a lot of disagreement in the church right now about theological ideas and their pastoral implementation. And I'm a canon lawyer by training, and there's a lot of debate about canonical principles and the way that they interplay with the church's life and ministry. And we do want to report on those ideas. We want to report on the controversy. We want to report on what the perennial teaching of the church is and how we can understand what's happening now in what Pope Benedict called a hermeneutic of continuity.
Yeah.
And that means that we look to see what's unified between what's happening now, how we can understand what's happening now in light of 2,000 years of the church's tradition and life. And so we do want to do that, and we want to recognize where there are issues to be hammered out, where there's ambiguity, where there's uncertainty. And we want to do that, again, because we want to be loyal sons and daughters of the church. We want to be faithful to what the church teaches, and part of that means we want to know what the church teaches and understand it well. But we at Catholic News Agency are genuinely blessed by the ministry of Francis and by his witness, as we were by Benedict and as we were by John Paul. Most of us are
but
too
JD,
young to remember anybody before John Paul. But
oh, I can't. Come on, you're a young kid. All right. So, but I guess my point is, like, there's going to be people who will say different things about what Francis has done this and what that. Some are very, you know, solid Catholic voices. Some are members of the episcopacy and all that. And so do you just report, just straight report, this person said this, this person said that? I mean, how do you, or I imagine you don't want to gloss controversy, but you also don't want to fan the flames of it.
We don't want to gloss controversy, and we don't want to fan the flames of it. That's exactly right. Somebody said to me today that it sometimes feels like there is a camp that just has almost, you know, a small camp in the church that has almost a sort of cult of personality where it's like, you know, seeing the Pope as a person who surpasses anything that's ever come before, and that's not where we want to be. And there's a camp in the church too that the Pope can't say anything without being the subject of criticism, and we don't want to be in that camp either. In fact, you spend 5 minutes with either camp and you just want to run and where you want to run is into the heart of the church, which sees the Pope as, again, as a successor of St. Peter, but recognizing, yeah, there are real theological controversies going on right now, as there were in the time of John Paul and as there were in the time of Benedict. And so what we're trying to do, I hope we're doing it, is report on the theological questions and talk with experts who can contextualize them for us. So when we want to understand Amoris Laetitia, we want to understand it in the context of Familiaris Consortio and in the context of Veritatis Splendor, in the context of Casta Canubi, in the context of the church's tradition and teaching. And so we try and talk with experts who can break down how we can understand what's happening now, how we can understand what's being said now in light of all that's come before us. You know, the idea that tradition is sort of the democracy of the dead, that those who came before us have the right to speak to us. And so we try to hear what's happening now in light of everything that's come before us as well.
888-318.
But it's not easy, you're right.
No, I imagine. 888-318-7884 is our number. There's another story I wanted to ask you about before I go back to callers. I have not really kept up on this story. Heard it today, and it's apparently already over, but this undocumented teenager in the United States who on whom an abortion was performed either today or yesterday. What is this story about?
Yeah, this is a very sad story. A young girl, a teenage girl, came to the United States from Central America. She snuck across the border and she was detained. And after coming to the United States, discovered that she was 15 weeks pregnant. She was in federal custody in a shelter in Texas, and wanted to procure an abortion. And the government's position was that they federal funding can't support or assist or enable abortion. And the government's position was that they did not want to be compelled to assist or enable with an abortion, which is the unjust killing of an unborn child. And so they wouldn't facilitate this or provide access to, provide medical access as they would in any case, but provide access to an abortion clinic or anything like that. They felt that that would be a violation of federal law. And so the girl, with the help of the American Civil Liberties Union, filed a lawsuit arguing that she should have a right to an abortion. And it went through the court, and one decision and another decision and another decision appealed. And yesterday, the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals decided that the girl had a right to have an abortion, and the federal government had an obligation to assist her in procuring that abortion, and ordered that be done if the girl chose it. And regrettably, it was reported today that she had an abortion. So it's a very sad story. Of course, we're praying for this young girl who clearly is probably caught up in something that's much bigger than her, but also is suffering the pains of having had an abortion and the trauma that comes along with that. So we're praying for her. It represents a lot of questions about what role the government has in providing an abortion. The government argued that it would be enabling an abortion by facilitating this girl going to an abortion clinic, and that federal law doesn't allow that. And yet the courts decided that they had an obligation to do exactly that. So that seems to be a real shift in understanding of the role of government, and even in what choice means, because in this case, not only did the court rule that the girl had the right to have a choice to have an abortion, but that the federal government had to facilitate that for her. So that's probably an evolution in law. We're going to be talking to lawyers and other scholars about that, but it's a sad story for sure.
It does seem like all this choice that we have, it seems to keep limiting other people's choices, though. I mean, I know,
right.
So if you just say the words bake a cake, you know, or bake the cake, everybody knows what you're talking about nowadays. Is religious freedom currently and in the coming years, do you anticipate it to be among the more important things that you have to report upon?
Yeah, domestically and internationally. So, you know, the Trump administration the Department of Justice issued really strong guidelines on religious liberty a couple of weeks ago, and saying that it would make that the government would have an obligation to make every single effort to respect the religious liberty of its citizens and not to impose on them. The president rolled back a lot of the provisions of the HHS mandate, recognizing thereby recognize the right of religious believers not to have to facilitate the use of contraception. But the challenge is all this stuff is happening kind of by executive order, back and forth. So if the administration changes, what else will change? It's a strange time for religious liberty, because it seems to be caught in kind of a partisan ping pong game. And that's domestically. Internationally, religious persecution around the globe is being widely reported as being in many ways an all-time high. That Christians especially, but other religious believers, are suffering persecution, forced relocation, martyrdom, Christians facing martyrdom around the world at exorbitant rates. The Chinese government announced this week that they would be cracking down on illicit religious groups, which includes the underground Catholic Church in China. So we face religious liberty threats here and abroad. I was talking to Archbishop Lurie, the Archbishop of Baltimore, who's headed the Religious Liberty Committee of the USCCB for several years, and he said something important. He said that when we protect religious liberty in the United States, we serve as a light to people in the rest of the world who are being persecuted for their faith, and who know intuitively that they have a right to religious freedom but don't have experience for it. We serve as a light to them and a hope to them, and also an encouragement to them to work for their own religious liberty. So it's important for us to protect our domestic religious liberty. In some ways,
we look at martyrdoms around the world and we think, wow, that's, it's profound, and it is profound. And we don't think that we can do anything about it. But even advocating, I think, here in the United States for the protection of our own religious liberty and the freedom of people to act in accord with their faith has impact around the world. And so it's a critically important issue. And as I say, I think religious liberty right now in the U.S. is kind of going to be in this partisan ping pong game for a long time.
J.D. Flynn, Editor-in-Chief of the Catholic News Agency, thanks so much for sharing this hour with us on the Church in the News.
Yeah, thank you. This was great.
And the website is, go ahead and give it where people can find Catholic News Agency.
Yeah, come check us out at catholicnewsagency.com. You can get our app, the Catholic News Agency app, wherever you get your apps.
Second best Catholic app you can get.
Facebook.
Sorry, I beg your pardon.
I'm doing the commercial now, but check us out at CatholicNewsAgency.com.
Okay, and, thanks, JD. We'll see you tomorrow for Open Forum, God willing. Thanks for joining us today on Catholic Answers Live.